We think church is more than a place to go on Sunday. We think church can happen anywhere. It happens when we work with those who are hungry, sick, or forgotten. When we stand together for justice and inclusion. And when we open our hearts to live a life inspired by God's love. That's putting beliefs into action. That's what it means to rethink church. Learn more at rethinkchurch.org, the people of the United Methodist Church.
That's me. Good morning again. I'm back safe and sound from exercising my First Amendment rights to peaceful assembly and freedom of speech. It is a good and great thing to be back here with you today in worship. We have come as the family of faith, as the body of Christ, to listen for God's voice, to listen for each other's needs and something's going on with the microphone. And so I'll say, may the Holy Spirit fill us in this time and fill this place. Fill our hearts that we may worship God in grace and truth and peace. Welcome to worship.
And good morning again, Central Church. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Carl Northrup. I've been on this group for a few years now. Seems like a long time. I'd like to welcome everybody who is joining us this morning through the internet and those who join us later on the TV broadcast. You are a part of our church family, and we welcome you the same as we welcome all the friends who are here in this sanctuary. Need to highlight a few announcements this morning. First of all, when you get a moment, please sign the burgundy pads there, red pads, purple pads, whatever they want to call them. Let those people know in your pew who you're sitting next to, and then greet them when we have our greeting here shortly. Highlighting a few of the announcements, we're a busy church here, obviously. Next Sunday is going to be Super Bowl Sunday, and super in more than one spelling. We'd like to have you bring some donated soup so that we can help out the Shepherd's Supper and chow. 2 weeks from today, the youth groups will be baking cookies. There is a sign-up sheet out in front of the office if you'd care to help the youth groups and their activities. Sign up in front of the sheet. $6 a dozen, $10 for 2 dozen. And in the past years, they've been pretty good. They disappear rather fast. Dinner with friends, kickoff is today after this service downstairs in the dining room. If you didn't necessarily sign up, you can sign up today. They'll be glad to welcome you as part of that program. Also today, 2 cents per meal deal. Today is the day, the last Sunday of the month, and that's how we support our Shepherd's Supper. It's still self-supporting and it is busy. And you're invited to join one time if you're interested in seeing how that operates. Down in the fellowship hall at 9:30 this morning, there was a first of a two-part series on transgender and gender nonconforming identities. The next session of that will be next Sunday at 9:30. You're invited to join there if you care to. Be sure to read your bulletin. There's a lot of activity going on all the time here, and you're welcome to join it. As we start our worship service, let us join in the call to worship as printed in the bulletin. Insiders and outsiders, the ones on top, the ones on the bottom.
We are here.
We call on the Lord. Right and wrong, left and right, strong of faith and weak of knees.
We are here.
The pre-convinced, the unconvinced, and the waiting to see.
We are here.
We call on you. We are here. Open our eyes, our ears, our hearts to your presence.
We are here. Let us in your way. Amen.
Let us pray together. Holy One, in your eyes, we are all beloved children. How often we forget that. How often we leave someone out. How often we believe ourselves to be in. We need to remember your reckless love that counts no cost, holds no grudges, bears no judgment. We need to make it our own. Grow your love in us and grow it beyond us as we bear witness to it in this world. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand if you're able and join together in singing number 436, The Voice of God is Calling. Another and greet each other in the peace of Christ.
So, I got a question for you today. Has anyone ever been mean to you? Has anyone ever been mean? Raise your hands if anyone's ever been mean to you. Grown-ups too. Has anyone ever been mean to you? Oh, wow. So, really? Somebody said something hurtful to you or said something ugly to you once upon a time? Yeah. Right. All right, here's a harder one. Raise your hand, grown-ups too, if you've ever been mean to somebody else. Yeah. We all do it sometimes, don't we? It's not a very good thing, is it? Right? We shouldn't be mean to other people, should we? No, because how do you feel when someone's mean to you? Well, how does that make you feel? Sad, makes you feel really bad, hurts your feelings when somebody's mean to you, makes you feel really sad and upset inside, doesn't it, when someone's mean to you? So how do you think it feels when we're mean to somebody else? Why don't you sit up, London? Okay. How do you think that feels when we're mean to somebody else? Do you think they feel the same way? Yeah. You think it hurts inside too when you're mean to somebody else? So, do you think, here's another question. I have lots of questions today. Do you think Jesus was ever mean to anybody?
No.
But they were mean to him. You're right. Girl, you're going to preach someday. Do you think Jesus would want us to be mean to somebody else? No way, right? That's so rude. You're right. That would be rude if we were mean to other people all the time, wouldn't it be? Yeah? So how do you think we can stop being mean to people? How do you think that people can stop being mean? Say nice things instead of ugly things, right? You can say stop when somebody's being mean to you. Can you, or you can ignore them. What about if you see someone being mean to somebody else?
Speak for yourself.
You should say stop. You should say something, right? Yeah. Or you can stand with somebody. You can be with somebody if somebody's being mean to them, right? A friend. You can be a friend. Do you think that's what Jesus would want us to do? Be a friend? To stop being mean? Do you think the world would be a better place if we could all stop being mean to each other?
Yeah.
I do too, don't you? Do you think the world would be a better place if we'd stop being mean to each other? See what the grown-ups say. What do you think?
Yes.
Yeah? Yeah. It's not easy though, is it? Sometimes you want to be mean. Sometimes it feels pretty good to get that feeling off your chest, doesn't it? Yeah. So we got to learn some patience, right? And kindness. Don't you think?
Yeah.
I think that's what Jesus would want, don't you?
Yeah.
So how about this week? Can everybody make a promise? Can you make a pinky promise with somebody next to you? Pinky. What's your pinky? Can you make a pinky promise? Can everybody pinky promise this week?
No.
To not be mean this week? To stop when you have a mean thought? Can you make a promise? Can you say, repeat after me, I promise? I promise. All right. So let's see how far that promise goes this week, okay? Can we do that? All the way to heaven. That promise should go all the way to heaven. I think you're right, London. That's really good.
Or all the way along.
All the way down into our hearts too, right? So, all right. So we're going to go out. We're going to be kindness forces in the world this week, aren't we? No mean, right? And if we see somebody being mean, we're going to stand up for the person being mean to. Good for you. Yeah. And for your friends, yeah.
Or what about?
You can help someone stand up for themselves, can't you? Yeah. Well, then you go get a grown-up. Okay? Okay. Should we have a prayer before you go back to your grown-ups?
Yes.
All right. Yes. Can you repeat after me?
Yes.
Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for Jesus.
I mean, really, thank you for Jesus. He teaches us to love. He teaches us to be kind.
Help us to be that way.
Amen. Amen. Thanks for coming up, guys.
Oh, Our first scripture this morning is from Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 to 12. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up to the mountains, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, and for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were there before you.
Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord.
Let's sing together, Be Thou My Vision, hymn number 451 in the red hymnal. As we turn to a time of prayer, we note the number of people who need our prayers this week. On the back of the bulletin is the listing of those people who we especially note for this week. In the hospital or recovering are Joan Thomas, Marty McGee, Dave Henderson, and Charlie Witt is home now. In our prayer program that we conduct each week, the following people are need we will be praying for this week: Dale Albeck, Dee Brinzer, Dave and Connie Darrow, Ray Frederick, Gary and Emma Holmes, Renee Kopsik, Edward and Jacqueline Miller, Katie and Adrian Rodriguez, Cindy and Joseph Tedeschi, David and Eileen Wright. Among our larger church family and friends, Alberta Pewterbaugh, Alexis Ferrist, Roseberry Knotts, Carol Kendall, Tony Luparello, Abel and Jen, Sam Price, Dave Darrell, Bob Oney, and Cheryl, and our many homebound members. And we would like to extend sympathy to the family of Bob Armitage. His service will be February 6th at 11 a.m. Let's join together in prayer.
We come to prayer also as Americans who've had an interesting first week of the new presidency. Ironically, I chose that picture, that image, few weeks ago, bless you, but yesterday our country put a target on persons of another faith. Jesus taught us to love our neighbors as ourselves, and strangely enough used an illustration to demonstrate that, and the illustration was about someone of an opposing religious tradition. And so my heart hurts today. My heart hurts for folks who went out of the country for visits home from school and for now, temporarily, may be able to get back in, but may not in the long run. My heart hurts for families separated, wondering if they will ever be reunited. My heart hurts. My heart just hurts. For all those folks who were surprised yesterday and broken-hearted. And so we bring that tumult into our prayer today as well. Let us be in prayer together. Holy and living and loving God, we come to you today knowing that you have blessed us. You have called us blessed people. And you have called us to be a blessing as well. You have called us to be peacemakers. You have called us to walk in humility. You have called us to be meek. You have called us to love. You have called us to be salt and light in this world. You have called us to be your love and your grace in all times and all places. And we admit that sometimes that's hard. Sometimes we find ourselves on the polar opposite end of an issue from someone else. Sometimes we find ourselves being mean. Sometimes we find ourselves choosing the expedient over the right. And so we come before you in all states of readiness to be your grace-filled people. We ask that you be with each one of us. Fill us with your purpose, your power, your passion, your courage, your conviction that we see in the living, breathing life of Christ. When we are confused, enlighten us. When we are afraid, strengthen us. When we look the other way, remind us. Fill us above all with your love. We pray for huge things here this morning, huge shifts in our hearts and in our lives. We pray also for great things, for those whom we've named before you already, persons who are struggling with recovery and illness, obstacles, fears, worries, struggles. We've named so many already, but there are so many more we carry with us who aren't written on a bulletin somewhere, who aren't written on a piece of paper. Their names, their lives are important to us. They're our family, they're our friends, they're our neighbors. Each one of us struggles with something every day, sometimes small things, sometimes immense, overwhelming things. And so in this moment of prayer, as we come together all in our own need, we offer prayers for those we carry in our hearts as we speak their names out loud into this silence and space.
Joan.
You know each name. You know each struggle. You know each need. Help us to know how to help. Help us know how to serve. Help us know how to be your hands and feet in each life that we've brought before you this morning. Lord, in your love, hear our prayers. For we ask each one in the name of Jesus the Christ as we offer to you the prayer he first taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory.
Today's second reading comes from Micah chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. Listen now, listen to God. And God said, take your stand in court. If you have a complaint, tell the mountains. Make your case to the hills. And now, mountains, hear God's case. Listen, jury earth. For I am bringing charges against my people. I am building a case against Israel. Dear people, how have I done you wrong? Have I burdened you, worn you out? Answer, I delivered you from a bad life in Egypt. I paid a good price to get you out of slavery. I sent Moses to lead you, and Aaron and Miriam to boot. Remember what Balak, king of Moab, tried to pull, and how Balaam, son of Beor, turned the tables on him. Remember all those stories about Shittim and Gilgal. Keep all of God's salvation stories fresh and present. How can I stand up before God and show proper respect to the high God? Should I bring an armload of offerings, topped off with yearling calves? Would God be impressed with thousands of rams, with buckets and barrels of olive oil? Would God be moved if I sacrificed my firstborn child, my precious baby, to cancel my sin? But he's already made it plain how to live, what to do, what God is looking for in men and women. It's quite simple. Do what is fair and just to your neighbor. Be compassionate and kind and loyal in your love. And don't take yourself too seriously. Be humble. Walk humbly with God.
Have you noticed that mean is in? I don't know when it happened, or if it happened all at once, or if it happened just so gradually that we didn't notice it coming, but mean is in. We've always had a little bit of mean in political discourse in this country, you know, campaign electioneering and mudslinging and all that. I think we've always been able to say, well, that's just, you know, election year politics. It would disappear as soon as the first Tuesday of November had passed. You know, isolated meanness, chance of mud, mood clears by Wednesday, just a passing thing. That's always been with us. I'm not sure it's entirely past this time, but we'll see. I'm actually not talking about those isolated incidents of meanness. I'm talking about pervasive, culturally acknowledged, continuing meanness. I think the first time it really hit me that mean seemed to be the new paradigm was when the show Survivor came out. That first season, I didn't watch much, but everyone kept talking about it, and I haven't watched it since. Is it still running? We couldn't decide in the first. It's still on. It's still on. 15 years later or something. The whole thing in that show is about forming alliances and shifting alliances, and then voting people off the island. The weakest can't survive, so kick them off. Get rid of them. That's when I realized mean had made it. That's entertainment. And it's lasted over a decade. How about all the videos you see on Facebook, or if you're not on Facebook or social media, cast your mind back to America's Funniest Home Videos. Scene after scene after scene of people having terrible accidents, getting hurt, being embarrassed, kids, adults falling down, being mortified, captured on film. What is not mean about laughing at that? Oh, and those judges. You know who I'm talking about, American Idol fans. Telling people off, humiliating them on national television. When did we start to think that that was funny or acceptable? If you're not into the talent shows on TV, how about the cooking shows? Gordon Ramsay, do I need to say any more? Yelling at chefs everywhere on television. I think this is symptomatic of what I'm talking about. People have always been mean, always. But somehow, in some way, we've allowed it to become acceptable. It's a cultural norm now that we just wink at. But here's the thing. When we let meanness go unchecked, it becomes part of us. When we're not shocked by it, it loses its ability to shock us, and it ramps up as we become more and more immune. And we're passing that inoculation on to our children and to our children's children. I think the most alarming manifestation of it is the epidemic of bullying. It's not, and I'm not talking about the schoolyard, give me your lunch money kind of bully, or that I'm stronger or bigger than you, so I'm going to exert some power over you kind of bullying that we find in the schoolyard. That's bad enough. It still happens. It's terrifying enough to its victims. But, you know, we all knew the bullies. We all knew who they were. We could stay away from them, or you've been, who has not been bullied at school? Okay, you know what I'm talking about. We know the bullies. We know who they are. We know how to avoid them or run away from them or whatever. We could all guess that their problems came from somewhere else. Bullies today, though, are everywhere. And they're often anonymous. Very often you don't see them coming. We still have playground bullying. I'm not trying to dismiss it. That will never go away, I'm afraid. I wish it would. But we have bullying of far deeper consequence happening now. People are terrorized on the internet and on social media, in the classroom, in the workplace. People are harassed for who they are or who others think they might be, or from the targets other people place on them. Labels, names, expectations based on appearance or behavior or identity. Mean is in. And into that atmosphere, Scripture confronts us. What does God require? Do justice, love kindness, walk humbly. How do you do that when the world around you is behaving badly? How do you do that when you might just become a target for it? We've let the meanness take over, and we've laughed at it, and at times we've considered it entertainment. It has grown without us realizing it into its own life, like a cancer in our culture. Only now it's contagious. It's overwhelming. What do we do? What can we do? And are we willing to do it? That is where the rubber of our faith needs to hit the road. We cannot both believe in love and grace and justice and kindness and in acceptable cultural meanness. Those two things don't go together. Justice and bullying of whatever form cannot coexist. Love cannot be practiced at the same time as exclusion and oppression. It is, and always was, and always will be true that grace and hatred cannot grow in the same place. ever. Grace and hatred cannot grow in the same place. The ancient prophets were clear about it. Jesus was equally clear about it. Being a person of faith, being a person of God, being one who follows Christ requires a choice. Choose one, grace or not, love or not. With the choosing comes the very real challenge to live out your choice actively. Micah, this prophet we heard from this morning, does not say, think about justice, hope for kindness, imagine being humble. No, he doesn't. He's much more clear. Do justice, live kindly, walk humbly. How are we supposed to do that when the other stuff has been allowed to get so out of control? I think it's like that old riddle. How do you eat an elephant? How do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. It's the only way. One bite at a time. One step at a time. One refusal to be complicit at a time. One pointing out to a child or an adult that a mean act is wrong at a time. One step at a time. One choice at a time. NPR ran this story a long time ago on Morning Edition, and it's starting to make the rounds again. I thought I would share it with you this morning. If you've heard it before, I'm sorry, it's worth hearing again. Julio Diaz has a normal daily routine. Every night, the 31-year-old social worker ends his hour-long subway commute to the Bronx one stop early just so he can eat at his favorite diner. But one night, as he stepped off the train and onto a nearly empty platform, his evening took an unexpected turn. He was walking toward the stairs when a teenage boy approached him and pulled out a knife. Diaz says later, he wants my money, so I gave him my wallet and I told him, here you go. As the kid began to walk away, Diaz said to him, hey, wait a minute, you forgot something. If you were going to be robbing people for the rest of the night, you might as well take my coat to keep you warm. The would-be robber looked at his would-be victim like, what's going on? Diaz said later. He asked me, why are you doing this? Diaz replied, if you're willing to risk your freedom for a few dollars, then I guess you must really need the money. I mean, all I wanted to do was get dinner. And if you really want to join me, hey, you're more than welcome. He said later, you know, I just felt maybe he needed help. Diaz says he and the teen went into the diner and sat in a booth. The manager comes by, the dishwashers come by, the waiters come by to say hi, Diaz says. The kid was like, you know everybody here. Do you own this place? Diaz replies, no, I just eat here a lot. The kid said, but you're even nice to the dishwasher. Diaz said, well, haven't you been taught you should be nice to everybody? Yeah, but I didn't think people actually behaved that way. Diaz asked him what he wanted out of life. He just had a sad face, he says. The teen couldn't answer him, or he didn't want to. When the bill arrived, Diaz told the teen, look, I guess you're going to have to pay for this bill because you have my money, and I can't pay for it. But if you give me my wallet back, I'll treat you. The kid didn't even think about it. Returned the wallet, Diaz says. I gave him 20 bucks. I figure maybe it'll help him. I don't know. He said he asked for something from the kid in return. His knife. And he gave it to me. Afterward, when Diaz told his mother what had happened, she said, you know, you're the type of kid that if someone asked you for the time, you'd give him his watch. He says, I figure if you treat people right, you can only hope that they treat you right. It's as simple as it gets. That, my friends, is the gospel. That is the story of the prophets. That is the story of the Christ. That is the gospel. That can be our story too, by the grace of God. Thanks be to God for that. Amen. We're going to sing again. Those who sing, pray twice. It's a very new one for some of you. It's not for some of you. But I think it's very appropriate and you'll catch on quick. Should we stand? As you go into this week and into this world, do justice, love kindness, walk humbly with God, and may the courage and the power and the strength of the Christ go with you as you do. Amen. Go in peace.